Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info.
What do astronomers see when they gaze at the cosmos? Thanks to incredible technological leaps, the universe is now, quote, visible to a greater extent and in finer clarity than ever before. However, the detection and measurement of the remotest celestial phenomena is not as straightforward as it might seem. Like all scientific investigations, space exploration is a subjective human endeavor, and it stands to reason that the more remote the phenomena, the more open it is to interpretation. The evidence for the theoretical mechanisms that are thought to cause the largest scale cosmological phenomena, including unfathomable emissions of electromagnetic energy, are gleaned through inference by necessity. And what scientists infer is governed by what they believe. The fundamental belief behind more than a century of space science is that the predominant force in the cosmos is gravity. And even well into the space age, astronomers continued to model a universe in which plasma and both electric and magnetic fields played no significant role. In more recent years, astronomers have acknowledged that magnetic fields exist in space and may even play an organizational role at all scales in the cosmos. However, this revelation of the so-called magnetic universe has presented both intractable problems and paradoxically opportunities for scientists to try to preserve ad hoc the traditional Big Bang gravity-centric cosmology. A demonstration of these efforts can be seen in the recent Quanta magazine piece, titled "The Hidden Magnetic Universe Begins to Come into View." The article describes scientists' attempt to date cosmic magnetic fields back to the primordial era after the hypothetical Big Bang, an effort which they hope might resolve the so-called Hubble tension, or the apparent accelerating expansion rate of the universe. The article states, "Anytime astronomers figure out a new way of looking for magnetic fields in ever more remote regions of the cosmos, inexplicably, they find them. The question is, where did these enormous magnetic fields come from?" Astrophysicist Franco Gaza states of the problem, "It clearly cannot be related to the activity of single galaxies, or single explosions, or, I don't know, winds from supernovae. This goes much beyond that. Of course, as we've explained many times, the real reason cosmic magnetism is considered so, quote, inexplicable is because of most space scientists' ongoing, a priori dismissal of electric currents in the cosmos. This posture is described in the Quanta piece as follows. Magnetism is the only force apart from gravity that can shape the large-scale structure of the cosmos, because only magnetism and gravity can reach out to you across vast distances. Electricity, by contrast, is local and short-lived, since the positive and negative charge in any region will neutralize overall. But you can't cancel out magnetic fields. They tend to add up and survive." And here, we see emphasized institutionalized science's refusal to explore the well-developed concepts of plasma cosmology. For many decades, astronomers have assumed that plasma is a superconductor, which leads to a further assumption of so-called frozen-in magnetic fields in space. However, plasma physicists have known for many decades that when, quote, clouds of plasma move relative to each other, they generate electric currents in each other. As shown experimentally in plasma laboratories, electric currents in plasma take the form of twisted filament pairs, and these follow the direction of the ambient magnetic field. The filamentary current is electrically insulated from its surroundings. Experimental plasma physics has shown that charged bodies embedded in plasma produce around themselves a double layer, or what is also known as a Langmuir plasma sheath. This protective cocoon of plasma contains most of the voltage difference between a charged body and its surrounding plasma. As Nobel Prize winner Hannes Alfvén wrote in his 1987 paper, "Cosmology in the Plasma Universe," space is filled with a network of currents, which transfer energy and momentum over large or very large distances. The currents often pinch to filamentary or surface currents. The latter are likely to give space, also interstellar and intergalactic space, a cellular structure. Of course, both the vast networks of interstellar and intergalactic filaments, as well as the lifelike cellular structures seen in celestial objects such as nebulae, are seen in greater detail with each passing year. And as we outlined in a recent episode, Alfvén also emphasized the extraordinary cosmic significance of the well-known electromagnetic mechanism called the Bennett pinch, or the Z-pinch, the process by which stars form, rather than gravitational collapse and accretion. Alfvén's outrageous prediction that stars form like, quote, beads on a string along vast networks of filaments is one of many such predictions confirmed by space discovery. The evidence for cosmic electric currents on an even much vaster scale has grown increasingly undeniable. As we reported last year, in 2019, a team of scientists published their analysis of a vast radio-emitting filament of plasma, which stretches across 10 million light-years, connecting two clusters of galaxies, called Abel 399 and Abel 401. The filament, which a scientist discovered using a low-frequency radio telescope called LOFAR, also marked the first time scientists have found a magnetic field connecting two galactic clusters. The radio emission from the filament is called synchrotron radiation, which is produced by the tremendous acceleration of electrons along the filament at relativistic velocities. As stated by astronomer Matteo Murgia, we typically observe this emission mechanism in action in individual galaxies and even in galaxy clusters, but never before has a radio emission been observed connecting two of these systems. A ScienceAlert.com report on the discovery states, "The electrons are covering way more distance than is expected, which means there has to be another element at play." In the aforementioned Quanta magazine piece, the description of the radio-emitting magnetic filament inadvertently confirms the electrical interpretation. The article states that the scientists, quote, "inferred the presence of a magnetic field in the filament between galaxy clusters Abel 399 and Abel 401 from the way the field redirects high-speed electrons and other charged particles passing through it. As their paths twist in the field, these charged particles release faint synchrotron radiation." However, the scientists seem not to recognize what this must mean. The release of, quote, "faint synchrotron radiation" means the charged particles are losing energy, and thus they cannot continue to radiate over cosmic distances unless they are continually receiving electrical energy, which constitutes an electric current. We note that as far back as 1992, Dr. Anthony Peratt of Los Alamos Laboratories, himself a student of Hannes Alfvén, discussed the evidence for, quote, "supercluster-scale electric currents" in his textbook Physics of the Plasma Universe. In the chapter titled Currents in the Intergalactic Medium, Peratt writes, "One of the most compelling pieces of evidence for the existence of supercluster-sized currents comes from the discovery of faint supercluster-scale radio emissions at 326 MHz between the Coma cluster of galaxies and the Abel 1367 cluster. In Peratt's view, these intergalactic currents are spiraling Birkeland currents, which will accelerate charged particles in circles, which is to say orthogonal to the current's direction, which must then generate synchrotron radiation." Unfortunately, the scientists cited in the Quanta magazine piece are exclusively seeking answers in the so-called primordial universe, after the hypothetical Big Bang. The hope for believers in Big Bang cosmology is that these answers could resolve the problem of the apparent accelerating expansion rate of the universe. The scientists cited in the Quanta article examined computer simulations which attempt to demonstrate the effects of hypothetical primordial magnetic fields if they were present before an epoch called cosmic recombination, a hypothetical period a few hundreds of thousands of years after the Big Bang, in which charged electrons and protons first became bound to form electrically neutral hydrogen atoms. Their efforts to resolve the so-called Hubble tension are described as follows. Cosmologists calculate how fast space should be expanding today by observing ancient light emitted during recombination. The light shows a young universe studded with blobs that formed from sound waves sloshing around in the primordial plasma. If recombination happened earlier than supposed due to the clumping effect of magnetic fields, then sound waves couldn't have propagated as far beforehand, and the resulting blobs would be smaller. The upshot is that smaller blobs mean a higher inferred cosmic expansion rate, bringing the inferred rate much closer to measurements of how fast supernovas and other astronomical objects actually seem to be flying apart. The question we began this space news with, what do scientists actually see when they gaze into the cosmos, is especially pertinent here. Of course, the first assumption the scientists make is that the Big Bang actually happened. As we've discussed since the inception of this series, it was decades ago that the renowned astronomer Halton Arp showed that faint, highly redshifted objects like quasars are intrinsically faint because of their youth and not their distance. Arp and others such as Jeffrey and Margaret Burbage categorized numerous so-called anomalous objects of very different redshifts in impossibly close association with one another. Redshift is an intrinsic property of distant galaxies and quasars, and is not due to some modification of the light on its journey to Earth. In other words, cosmic redshift is not a reliable indicator of an object's distance and velocity of movement away from an observer on Earth. This view is compatible with the electric universe antidote to the so-called accelerating expanding universe, which does not rely on the invention of dark energy. As Thunderbolt's chief science advisor, Wal Thornhill, explains in his analysis of Type 1a supernovae, the quote, discovery of the acceleration of the expanding universe is an interpretation based on total ignorance of the real nature of stars and the standard candle, the supernova Type 1a. A supernova Type 1a is supposed to be due to a hypothetical series of incredible events involving a white dwarf star. But as I have shown, a supernova is simply an electrical explosion of a star that draws its energy from a galactic circuit. The standard candle effect and the light curve is simply due to the circuit parameters of galactic transmission lines, which power all stars. In plasma cosmology and the electric universe, the universe is of unknown extent and origin. And the electrical nature of both stars and galaxies along networks of Birkeland current filaments does resolve so-called inexplicable cosmic magnetism. It was many decades ago that plasma scientists began reproducing the evolution and form of galaxies through simple experiments with electrical discharge. The aforementioned Anthony Peratt recreated barred spiral galaxies in simulations with interacting twin current filaments, as seen on your screen. Unfortunately, long ago, the belief in the Big Bang solidified into a quasi-religious dogma. And today, institutionalized science continues to devote massive resources to promoting and affirming Big Bang cosmology, while ignoring the well-developed and experimentally verified concepts of plasma cosmology, whose predictive success only grows with each year. It is ironic that proponents of the Big Bang look to mysterious magnetism to save the untenable hypothesis, since it is magnetism that is the clearest indication of the electrical circuitry pervading the cosmos. Electric currents generate magnetic fields, and it is only electric currents that can create the impossibly well-ordered cosmic-scale magnetic fields that astrophysicists detect with increasing regularity, a phenomenon never predicted by proponents of gravity-centric cosmology. However, we do see some glimmer of hope among scientists studying the local picture in our own solar system, who are willing to infer the electric currents required for the magnetic fields in the environment near Earth. The electric current systems near our planet are the subject of the 2018 book, Electric Currents in Geospace and Beyond. The American Geophysical Union's Earth and Space Science News published a summary of the book titled Electric Currents in Outer Space Run the Show. The summary states bluntly, it is now understood that outer space is fundamentally electrical in nature. On the challenging task of measuring electric currents in space, the authors write, since electric currents are comprised of moving charged particles, such as ions and electrons, the most direct way to measure currents is by probing and counting the individual particles. Highly tuned instruments that fly on board satellites do exactly that. While particle counting is quite challenging, as one might expect, one can also make use of the fact that electric currents generate a magnetic field around them, which in turn can be measured more easily by instruments called magnetometers. From these magnetic fields, one can then infer, using Maxwell's equations, the underlying currents. And yet scientists cannot infer what they are not prepared to look for. As the early 20th century evangelist Oswald Chambers stated, seeing is never believing. We interpret what we see in the light of what we believe. But no belief is required to recognize the electrical nature of the cosmos. but rather only a willingness to follow the light of discovery wherever it may lead.